Okay, so we're going to start off with the bell ringer. Let's just review now, since we finally finished all four constitutional influences. What four are they? Enlightenment thinkers, we're all done with them, so that is one of them. And we all know and understand these influences, right? And these Enlightenment thinkers' beliefs. Okay, hence the research, right? So I'll let you guys work on this for a little bit, and we'll move on. Any more time? Mm-hmm. All right, one more minute. Love. That's true. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. All right, so let's go over this real quick. So where do we start with these constitutional influences? We all know the Articles of Confederation, they're too weak. And we need to do something, right? The United States, the Founding Fathers, they all decided, well, we need to revise the Articles of Confederation because of six weaknesses. Now, we talk about those six weaknesses. Soon enough, we'll talk about a little quiz on it here. And we'll test on that material. But that's kind of what pushed us in this direction. Okay, what rebellions caused us to maybe revise the Articles of Confederation? What were they? You guys remember? Tanner, go ahead. Shays Rebellion, good job. So on taxes, good. So in Massachusetts, all of a sudden, the weak federal government trying to tax the people to pay back some of these war debts. Good. And what other rebellion? There's a flag right up there about it. Chase? Yeah, the Whiskey Rebellion. Good job. And what was whiskey like for these people out in the frontier and in these colonies? Jamie, you remember?
What?
What was whiskey like to these people in the colonies? Yeah, it was like currency to them, right? Good job. Because we all know one of the weaknesses to the Articles was every state had their own form of currency. And with that being said, and how worthless the dollar was, especially with all this debt in the United States for the time from the war debts, has caused a lot of individuals just to use whiskey as a form of currency. And now all of a sudden, the weak central government decided to tax whiskey. Oh my gosh, terrible. What are we going to do? Well, a rebellion happens. And the United States, again, utilizing the military to put down these rebellions. So when you're looking at George Washington, was he famed and popular with everybody in the U.S.? Not really. Okay, yes, people respected him because of the Revolutionary War. But for the most part, he was viewed almost as a tyrant, almost as an absolute monarch, very similar to what King George was to many of these people, especially out in the frontier. It's like, oh my gosh, he's taxing everything. He's using the military to really enforce his ability, his intentions. Okay, good. So now revising the Constitution, they revised the Articles of Confederation. They just totally scrapped the idea and created their own government. Did they ask the people if they wanted to revise the Articles of Confederation? No, what the heck? The Founding Fathers just doing whatever they want? Crazy. So again, where do these influences come from? Where do we start? Tanner, go ahead.
Well, first there's separation of powers amongst you.
Okay, all right. So you're starting with the Enlightenment thinkers, right? So we're utilizing all the Enlightenment thinkers' abilities, these ideas and these beliefs to apply to creating our Constitution. And Montesquieu, separation of powers. Rousseau, social contract. We talked about who else? John Locke, life, liberty, and property. Okay, these liberties, these freedoms that can't be taken away from us. Right? And there's many other ones, obviously, that were utilized for the Enlightenment thinkers. Good. So Enlightenment thinkers is one influence. Okay. And obviously you guys researched and we went through it. We presented the information to describe exactly what they brought to the U.S. government. What's another one, Jeffrey? Okay. So English influence, right? The Magna Carta. So we're looking to England, actually, who we broke away from for influence on our government, on our Constitution. So yeah, the Magna Carta, making sure that the government isn't above the law. Okay. So that there's a constitution is above the government. Good. Right. We also talked about the unwritten constitution. So these traditions, these values that are not necessarily written down, but we follow. Okay, what else do we get from England? The Bill of Rights, right? Okay, yeah, the English Bill of Rights. So we're expanding on the Bill of Rights. Okay, these rights that are given to the people. Who else do we look to for influence? Creating our Constitution. So we talked about Enlightenment thinkers, talked about England. Who else? Brock? Okay, so Enlightenment thinkers, Voltaire falls under a separation of church and state. Yep. But who else? Go ahead.
Ancient Greece and Rome.
Yeah, ancient Greece and Rome. Good job. Another pillar, another constitutional influence. Good. So with that representative democracy, right, where we're going to elect officials to represent us and our beliefs, our ideas, our thoughts of way the government should be run. Awesome. And we talked about the branches of government, talked about even the architecture in the United States of these government buildings, how it reflects ancient Rome. Good. And finally, last influence. So you have the Enlightenment thinkers, England. Okay, we have, like you mentioned, ancient Greece and Rome. Who else? The last one. What's the last influence here? Tanner?
Colonial heritage.
There you go. Yeah, colonial heritage. Good job. So colonial heritage. What was already established here in these colonies where we can look to and, you know, obviously create a constitution? You want to add to that one, Tanner?
The House of Burgesses,
legislative body. Okay, it's unicameral at the, you know, okay, it's unicameral. We'll change that to a bicameral system, which we'll get into more, most likely tomorrow, okay, maybe Thursday. But yeah, so a legislative body, okay, which is going to be the first article of the Constitution, creating the legislative branch, which is going to hold the most power. These representative officials, these representatives, these republic, okay, they're going to obviously have the ability to create laws. And they're voted on by the people. And then we talked about what the Mayflower Compact that falls under that constitutional heritage and how that's important. All right, good. Is there any questions on that, guys? So again, we start ancient Greece and Rome, okay, England, obviously colonial heritage, and the Enlightenment thinkers. All four of those influences help create our Constitution. The founding fathers are looking at those influences to advance us, right? To help create a sound government, one that's never been seen before. Okay, it's going to be almost like a beacon for everybody all around the world to see exactly how the people are represented and how the people choose the government. All right, good. Terms for today, I don't think I have any, actually. Nope, I don't. So we're going to move right into the notes. Right into the notes here. So where did they meet? Where do you think they met to revise the Articles of Confederation? In other words, just trash the articles and come up with a new form of government. Jeffrey?
Philadelphia.
Good job. So in Philadelphia, delegates from 12 states, not 13, okay, came together to try to revise the Articles of Confederation, create a new government. They asked the people for it? No. Anything, they needed all 13 states to come together to revise the articles. And here we only have 12. So already we're breaking the rules. Tanner, we're already breaking the rules, right?
Yep.
Oh my gosh, crazy. Well, hey, America, we can do what we want, right? We can do what we want. So has anybody ever visited Independence Hall? Yeah, Brock, have you ever seen it? Visited it before, Philadelphia? Yeah, pretty cool. Along with the Liberty Bell right next to it. Pretty neat. Jeffrey, you ever visited Independence Hall?
Once or twice,
okay. Terrence? No? Oh, man, you got to check it out. Not too far away, just in Philly. All right, so who was there? Well, we had the Founding Fathers, and they had delegates from 12 states. The one who was missing, Rhode Island. Why do you think Rhode Island decided not to go? Why do you think they may have skipped out on this convention here? Jeffrey, what do you think?
Because they did not agree with the revival of the Articles of Confederation.
Okay, all right. So they're a little upset maybe about a strong federal government, right? They're mainly based off of religious freedom. I know Pennsylvania is this holy experiment where all religions come together and live in harmony. But in Rhode Island, they believe if we try to achieve a stronger central government, this will eliminate the state's rights. Okay, this will eliminate a lot of the freedoms of religion in the states. So Rhode Island, they didn't join. So 55 delegates, including George Washington, Madison, Franklin, and Hamilton. A couple of key no-shows, though. Who's not there, you think? Who's not there? A couple of founding fathers weren't there. Who do you think? This might be a test question here. Who decided not to show up? Jeffrey, who do you think?
John Adams.
Okay. All right. Yeah, so he wasn't there. Who else? Who do you think, Jeffrey? Okay, kind of. I'm looking more towards Thomas Jefferson here. He was maybe skipping out. He's maybe skipping out. Maybe he had a little bit of other doings around creating peace. Okay, trying to establish an ally with France. Yeah, okay. So we'll talk about that. But anyway, here we go. So most of the people, delegates, businessmen, lawyers, bankers, shippers, farmers, or plantation owners, these are very wealthy individuals. Okay, they were established at the highest economic social standing. Some owned slaves, which we'll talk about with the Three-Fifths Compromise and how that's going to be needed to deal with before we move on in creating our Constitution. And already creating, you know, this new country, the origins of the United States, we're already having a debate about slavery. Okay, and this is obviously going to lead to the Civil War. Just under 80 years from this point. So it's amazing to think about. Already we see disputes about slavery just in the origins of our country, okay, of the creation of our Constitution. This is already starting issues and heat towards this debate, this issue here. So oldest one there, Ben Franklin, youngest, Jonathan Dayton. And no-shows, John Adams, he was in London, trying to dispute from the Revolutionary War. Thomas Jefferson, same thing, trying to establish a strong ally with France. And Patrick Henry, he said he's not going to come. Why do you think Patrick Henry said no? Remember, he's like, give me liberty or give me death. Why do you think he decided not to come? Do you think he was for this assembly to create a stronger national government, Tanner, do you think? Now, yeah, Alexander Hamilton kind of called this together. He wanted a stronger national government, stronger federal government, and many individuals like Patrick Henry, delegates from Rhode Island, did not want this. They didn't want a strong central government. This will just bring back the horrors of an absolute monarchy, mate. Okay? And this is supposed to be something for the people. All right, so why did they meet? Well, again, try to revise the Articles of Confederation, but in all reality, it established a new constitution, a new government, okay, a new government. At the time, none of the founding fathers believed this would create a new form of government. Again, they just thought they're going to revise the Articles, but overall, just scrapping the Articles and starting fresh, starting new. Taking these ideas of a three branches of government, okay, separation of church and state, and having these rights that were not limited, okay, that were above the government, and that were given to the people. We know the Bill of Rights, okay, what we know of is the branches of the government, judicial branch, executive, legislative branch, and how this is establishing something new, like the world's never seen before. When you're looking at the Constitution, this is probably one of the most significant pieces of paper ever written. Okay, this really gave the freedoms to the people above the government. Like I mentioned, the world's never seen this before. Nothing like this. Where people had these freedoms that government couldn't control of, which makes the United States unique, right? And is this beacon of hope for the rest of the world of democracy. All right, so again, we'll talk about this more tomorrow, but here's the rules that I kind of set out from the beginning. So the president of the convention, George Washington, he didn't want to really be the president of this. He didn't want to be the leader, but he was famed. He was popular amongst the people. So if rebellions ever were to rise again, he was so famous and popular that, you know what, he's respected. Okay, so that these citizens, these people, let's say of Pennsylvania, that might be angry of the founding fathers coming together trying to create a new form of government, they're like, you know what? We respect George Washington. He led us through the Revolutionary War, and it's really hard to go against this man. So three simple rules, one state, one vote. Well, we're going to see and talk about this is going to be some issues. arising already. Okay, so maybe some bigger states deserve more say, more representation. And that's going to be a dispute already with some of the plans coming up with the bicameral system. All right, so, and finally here, keeping the proceeding secret. Don't tell the public. Uh-oh, already. Founding father starting off on maybe not such a hot foot. Okay, this might anger the people. This might anger some of the citizens to rebel against the government already. It's like, why aren't they informed of what's going on with this new form of government? A little shady stuff. What do you think, Jeffrey? Think it's shady? Yeah, they should be reporting of what's being said and what's being disputed. Okay, trying to inform the people of what type of government the founding fathers are trying to establish. All right, is there any questions on that, guys? We good? Yes? Who's saying that? Taylor? Oh, of course you are. Okay. All right. So, TNN today, let's get to it.
What do you mean by that?
Oh, what do you mean by you're good? You're done. You don't want any more of this, huh?